أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. الحمد لله رب العالمين، وصلى الله على أشرف الخلق وعز المرسلين، المبعوث رحمة للعالمين، سيد الخلائق أجمعين، أبي القاسم محمد. اللهم صل على محمد وآل محمد، صلى الله عليه وعلى أهل بيته الطيبين الطاهرين، سفن النجاة وعين الحياة، من طهرهم الله بنص كتابه المبين وجعل اللعنة على أعدائهم أجمعين. Respected brothers and sisters, assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. We'll start our program tonight with remembering Sayyida Zainab alayha salam as we celebrate her birth anniversary. Sayyida Zainab alayha salam, who was born from two infallibles and who was raised between two infallibles. They mention a story that happened between Sayyida Zainab alayhi salam and her father Amirul Mu'mineen salamullahi alayhi. They say once Imam Ali alayhi salam was sitting down and playing with Sayyida Zainab when she was only 3 or 4 years old. And this is a message to the parents to have some time to sit down and play with their kids, especially for the fathers. Even if you are busy, even if you are tired, try to have 5-10 minutes every day where you sit down and you play with your kids to build this connection between you and them. Unfortunately, some men, they say, this is not for us to sit down and play with kids. This is something the woman should do. It's not suitable for us. And we say to them, are you better than Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi, who used to sit on the floor and play with Imam al-Hasan and Imam al-Husayn alayhim as-salam? Or are you better than Amir al-Mu'mineen salamullahi alayhi, who used to sit down and play with his daughter Sayyida Zainab alayhi salam? So Imam Ali alayhi salam was sitting down, and he said to his daughter, Bunayya quli wahid, say one. He's teaching her how to count. She said one, واحد. قال بني قول لي اثنان, say two. Sayyida Zainab alayhi salam, she stayed quiet. She didn't say anything. He asked her, why did you stay silent? Why didn't you say anything? Can't you say two? She said, I can, but I don't wish to mention anything after I mentioned the one. So she linked the number to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And that shows the greatness of the Ahlul Bayt alayhim salam. As they reach this level of infallibility or purity, due to connecting everything to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Everything they did in this life was for the sake of Allah. They lived for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. They worked for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And they died for the sake of Allah and in the path of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And that's why they were excluded from the verse that we are going to speak about tonight. إِنَّ الْإِنسَانَ لَفِي خُسْرٍ. This verse, it does not include the Ahlul Bayt alayhimu salam. When you connect everything you do to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, when you connect your existence, or when you understand that your existence is connected to the one who created you, then you'll be excluded from this verse. But for the fallible people like us, we have to stand and reflect on the second verse of Surah Al-Asr, which that says, Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim, Inna al-insana lafi khusr. Surely man is in loss. Which means surely man is in loss. And in tonight's discussion, inshallah, we have 3 points that we want to speak about. In the first point, we ask, what is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala emphasizing on in this verse? In the second point, why is man in loss? We ask, why is man in loss? And in the third point, inshallah, we are going to speak about the importance of choosing the terms when preaching Islam. We start with having the correct intention of attending this gathering for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. وببركة الصلاة على محمد وآل محمد. اللهم صل على محمد وآل محمد. If you look at this verse, إِنَّ الْإِنسَانَ لَفِي خُسْرٍ, surely man is in loss, you would be astonished from the strong confirmation that it holds. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala emphasizes on something important using the words of the verse, using the letters of the verse, and using the sentence altogether. So the words or the letters, it shows that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is emphasizing on something important. The words of the verse, it shows that Allah is emphasizing on something important. And the sentence altogether also, it shows that Allah is emphasizing, which is called in Arabic at-ta'kid. When you look at the first term in the verse, inna, surely. Inna, in Arabic grammar, is the lira that is used to confirm or to emphasize on something that is important. You say, harfun yufidu at-tawkid. A lira that you use when you want to emphasize on something that is important. This is inna. So this is the first lira, inna. It shows that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is emphasizing on something that is important. Then the verse says, al-insan, inna al-insan. Al-insan, if you look at al-insan, the term al-insan, you find that it was used as a collective noun, which means, or which confirms, that all mankind are included in this verse. Because it is a collective noun, it shows or it confirms that all mankind are included in this verse, إِنَّ الْإِنسَانَ لَفِي خُسْرٍ. And then the sentence altogether, إِنَّ الْإِنسَانَ لَفِي خُسْرٍ, is a nominal sentence, جملة اسمية. In Arabic grammar, جملة الاسمية تفيد التوكيد, which means the nominal sentence, it emphasizes on something that is important, it confirms something that is important. We should ask, what is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala emphasizing on in this verse? Allah azza thana'uh is emphasizing on one reality, which is the loss of mankind. This is the reality that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is emphasizing on. And if you look at the term khusr, إِنَّ الْإِنسَانَ لَفِي خُسْرٍ, this word khusr, which means loss, we see that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala used a descriptive word, wasf, a descriptive word. If Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala used, for example, the term khasir instead of khusr, khasir, which is dharfiyya, dharfiyya, a circumstantial word, yani it's linked to a certain incident, a certain time, a certain place. If he used this word term khasir, we would have understood that loss, or we would have understood that man is losing in some aspects of his life only, when you use the term khasir. For example, you can lose in a certain business, you can lose in a certain game, and win in a different business, in a different game. So you're only losing in a certain aspect of your life. But when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala used the descriptive word, or when He used the descriptive word khusr, we understood from that that loss is surrounding mankind from all aspects of life and from all dimensions. It is like you are under the water. If you look on top of you, you'll see water. To the right, to the left, under you, you'll see that water is surrounding you. The same thing with al-khusr, with loss to mankind. It's surrounding us from all dimensions and in all aspects of life. This is the first point. In the second point, we ask, why is man in loss? If we return back to the Quran, we find that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentioned the loss of mankind, the loss of the soul, the loss of the family, the loss of money, the loss of this life and the hereafter in 70 places. In 70 places in the Quran, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala speaks about this topic, which shows how important it is, and which shows that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is emphasizing on it. And it makes us as believers, stand and reflect on the meaning of this verse and to ask, why is man in loss? As you know, mankind should supposed to be the best of creation that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created. If we follow the path of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, if we perform our obligations and we stay away from committing sins, we would be definitely higher than animals and even higher than angels. We are the best of creation that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created. But with that, we see that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, surely, which means surely man is in loss. Always remember this when you want to translate the Quran, don't say Allah says and mention the English verse. Right? You say which means and you mention the English verse. You mention the Arabic verse. In Allah said, إِنَّ الْإِنسَانَ لَفِي خُسْرٍ, which means surely man is in loss. When we look at this verse, we feel that humanity itself is the reason why we are in loss. In other words, the essence of mankind, which is the soul is the essence of the mankind. When I say I, what I am referring to, when I say I, what do I refer to this body? No, I refer to the soul that occupies this body. So when we look at this verse, إِنَّ الْإِنسَانَ لَفِي خُسْرٍ, we understand that the essence of mankind, which is the soul, is the reason why we are in loss. So we can say that loss is an internal fact. If Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, for example, إِنَّ الْإِنسَانَ الْكَافِرَ لَفِي خُسْرٍ, surely the disbeliever is in loss, we would have understood that the reason for being in loss is what? Is disbelief. It's an what, external fact. But when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, إِنَّ الْإِنسَانَ لَفِي خُسْرٍ, it shows that it's an internal fact. And to explain this point, to explain how being a human being in itself makes us in loss, we can mention a few verses from the Quran. As I said, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentioned in 70 places in the Quran. So because we don't have enough time to mention 70 verses and explain them, inshallah, we're just going to mention 4 of them. The first verse that can explain to us this verse, إِنَّ الْإِنسَانَ لَفِي خُسْرٍ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم, يُرِيدُ اللَّهُ أَن يُخَفِّفَ عَنْكُمْ وَخُلِقَ الْإِنسَانُ ضَعِيفًا, which means, and Allah wants to lighten for you your difficulties, and mankind was created weak. Man was created with weakness. We have weak bodies. They say, as a scientific theory, and not a fact, it's not a fact yet, but as a scientific theory, they say that you can only stay awake for 11 days, 264 hours. After that, you'll die. For 11 days only. You can stay awake 264 hours. Now it's a theory, it's not a fact yet. But even if you don't sleep for one night, you feel tired and you feel weak. This is how weak we are. We can't even stay awake for one night or two nights without feeling the weakness inside of us. We are weak in our will, with the will that we have, as we are limited with this physical existence. We are limited in this physical body that we have. How many times we promise ourselves to change the wrong things that we do? How many times you sit between you and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and you promise yourself, I'm going to change, I'm going to leave this path, I'm going to stop performing this sin, I'm going to stop going to this place, and so on. And you find that after a few hours or after a few days, you return back to commit the same mistake. You return back to commit the same sin. We are weak in changing ourselves, let alone to change others. We are always busy, especially the brothers and sisters in the community. They are always busy in working, and may Allah reward them in the community. They work to change others, to change the community, to help the community. Well, it's more important to sit down and to change ourselves first, to work on ourselves first. And then when we reach a certain level of obedience in the path of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, then we go out and we start preaching others. And inshallah, tonight I'm not sitting here preaching others, I'm preaching myself first before I preach others. We feel also our weakness in front of the problems that we face in life. Sometimes you face a problem and you sit down, you don't know what to do or how to work. You feel weak in front of a small problem that you face in this life. We are weak in our knowledge. We learn to know that we know nothing. And we are weak in practicing the knowledge that we learn. When it comes to implementing the knowledge that we learned, we are weak. We find it hard to implement it. In every moment we are losing. In every moment we are losing power. In every moment we are losing time. In every moment we are losing life. That's why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, out of His mercy, and because He doesn't want to put pressure on His servants, He lightened for us our difficulties. يُرِيدُ اللَّهُ أَن يُخَفِّفَ عَنْكُمْ. He wants to lighten your difficulties. Why is that? Because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَخُلِقَ الْإِنسَانُ ضَعِيفًا. And mankind was created weak. And this explains why man, or the humanity itself, or the essence of mankind, which is the soul, is the reason why mankind are lost at the same time. It works. This is the first verse. The second verse, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and this is a very interesting verse that we can all relate to. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim, وَإِذَا مَسَّ الْإِنسَانَ الضُّرُّ دَعَانَ لِجَنْبِهِ أَوْ قَاعِدًا أَوْ قَائِمًا فَلَمَّا كَشَفْنَا عَنْهُ ضُرَّهُ مَرَّ كَأَنْ لَمْ يَدْعُنَا إِلَى ضُرٍّ مَسَّهُ كَذَلِكَ زُيِّنَ لِلْمُسْرِفِينَ مَا كَانُوا يَعْمَلُونَ. Which means, and when affliction touches man, when you face a problem, he calls upon us, he calls upon Allah, whether lying on his side or sitting or standing, but when we remove from him his affliction, he continues in disobedience, and as if he had never called upon us to remove the problem that he is facing. Perhaps we can all relate to this verse as it speaks about the loss of mankind. Now be honest, and you don't have to reply or answer this question. How many times you remember Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in your day? Away from your obligatory prayers, away from the wajib prayers that you perform, how many times you actually sit down and you remember Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? How many times you remember our Master Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi? Be honest with yourself. Once, twice, yani if you're a pious believer, you remember him twice a day, away from your salat. We're always busy, at work, at uni, playing, having sahrat, and so on. But the moment we fail, the moment we fall into a problem, we keep remembering Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. In every moment of our day, we remember Allah when we fall into a problem. وَإِذَا مَسَّ الْإِنسَانَ الضُّرُّ دَعَانَا. And when affliction touches man, he calls upon us. He doesn't call upon us once or twice or only in his salat, in every moment in his life. دَعَانَ لِجَنْبِهِ أَوْ قَائِمًا أَوْ قَاعِدًا. When you face the problem, you remember Allah and you call him while lying down, while sleeping, and while sitting down, قَائِمًا وَقَاعِدًا, and while standing during salat and during the work that you perform in this life. So wherever you are, when you face a problem, you start remembering Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But when the problem finishes, and when you feel that you are safe, Most of the times we forget Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We return to remember Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala part-time, only in our salat. It's like we have a part-time relation with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, to remember Him five times in our salat. And now because we join between the salat, so we remember Him three times a day. And some people who don't wake up for salat al-subh, they remember Him twice a day. Right? That's it. فَلَمَّا كَشَفْنَا عَنْهُ ضُرَّهُ مَرَّ كَأَنْ لَمْ يَدْعُنَا إِلَى ضُرٍّ مَسَّهُ. It is like you've never been through the problem that you ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to remove you from it. And what is worse is that after Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala save you from the problem, you return back to the sin that caused you to be in the problem that you face. You face problems in your life sometimes due to the sins that you perform. Not always, sometimes it's due to the sins that you perform. Sometimes Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants to test you. But some of the problems are based on, are only an effect for the sins that you perform. When Allah saves you from this problem, you return back to disobeying Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. I remember at school, one of my cousins, I don't want to mention his name, Maskeen. He never used to pray. Only before exams, he used to start praying. But once I asked him, why do you pray before the exams? Like, and I'm asking Allah to help me in my exam. So he prays during the exam, and after he finishes from the exam, he stops praying. He has a business with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And help me, I'll pray for you. If you don't help me, I'm going to stop praying for you. And even if Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala helps him and he succeeds, you find after a few months, he'll stop praying. I don't know now if he's praying or not. Third verse. Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. Alhamdulillah, we are improving from last week. Yani the first week, 2 weeks ago, I used to mention a joke and no one used to laugh. At least this week, we have some people laughing. It makes me feel happy. Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. خلق الإنسان من نطفة فإذا هو خصيم مبين. Which means He created man from a sperm drop, then at once he is a clear enemy. This verse also explains why man is in loss. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created you with a soul. And He gave you a body, a physical body to use in this material life. But for this reaction to happen between the soul and the body, you need power. True or not? Same as driving a car. You have a driver and you have a car. But to drive the car, you need petrol, you need power. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave you this power. And we refer to this power as the spirit, ar-ruh. And perhaps this is the difference between an-nafs and ar-ruh. Nafs is the essence of mankind, it's our reality. The body is nothing. The body is just a tool that you use. And ar-ruh, the spirit, is the power that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala placed inside of you for this reaction to happen. But what is interesting, that we do not own this spirit that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala placed inside of us. This spirit is from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and it is for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. It's from Him, and it is for Him. We do not own ourselves to own anything, or to own any power. So whatever we are doing, we are using the power of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That's why we always say la hawla wa la quwwata illa billah. We should understand that we are nothing. خلق الإنسان من نطفة. He created man from a sperm drop. But out of our arrogance, we fail to understand this reality. And we think that we own everything that we have in this material life. And we use the power of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in disobeying Him. When you commit a sin, you are using the power of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So it is like you have taken, wal'iyadu billah, we have taken Allah as our enemy. And we deal with Him with enmity, because we know that He is the one who created us. And we know that He is the one who owned this power that we have. And with that we use it to commit sins. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, فَإِذَا هُوَ خَصِيمٌ مُبِينٌ. Then at once He is a clear enemy. A man becomes a clear enemy to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This verse, it explains how man is in loss. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim, وَآتَاكُمْ مِنْ كُلِّ مَا سَأَلْتُمُوهُ وَإِنْ تَعُدُّوا نِعْمَةَ اللَّهِ لَا تُحْصُوهَا إِنَّ الْإِنسَانَ لَظَلُومٌ كَفَّارٌ. Which means, and He gave you from all the things that you've asked. And if you should count the favor of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, you would not be able to do so. You cannot count the blessings that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala give us, or the favors that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala blesses us with. And you cannot thank Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in the way that He should be thanked. How do we respond to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? And how do we respond to the blessings and the favors that He gives us? There's a very important dua which I advise myself, my brothers and my sisters to read it every now and then. Dua Abu Hamza Thumali radwanullah alayh, where the Imam alayhi salam, he explains this relation that we have between us and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He says to Allah, تَتَحَبَّبُ إِلَيْنَا بِالنِّعَمِ وَنُعَارِضُكَ بِالذُّنُوبِ. You show love towards us, or you show affection to us through your graces, and we take ourselves away from you through our sins. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He tries to show His love to us through the blessings and the favors that He gives us, and in return we send Him some of the sins that we perform. خَيْرُكَ إِلَيْنَا نَازِلٌ. Your good descends down to us. وَشَرُّنَا إِلَيْكَ صَاعِدٌ. Everything that comes from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is good. Especially now we're remembering Sayyidah Zainab alayhi salam, a very famous saying. She said, مَا رَأَيْتُ إِلَّا جَمِيلًا. I have not seen except beauty, as long as it is connected to Allah. So everything that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sends down is good. وَشَرُّنَا إِلَيْكَ صَاعِدٌ. While our evil doing rises to you. This is the reality, or it reflects the relation between us and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The fourth verse, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim, قل لو أنتم تملكون خزائن رحمة ربي إذا لأمسكتم خشية الإنفاق وكان الإنسان قطورا. Which means, say, if you own the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, if you own this treasure that contains the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, then you would withhold out of fear of spending. You would withhold out of fear of spending. And ever has man been stingy. In this verse, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He gives us an example to show the loss of mankind. He says, قُلْ لَوْ أَنْتُمْ تَمْلِكُونَ خَزَائِنَ رَحْمَةِ رَبِّي. If you get the authority to run this treasure that contains the mercy of Allah, and you know that the mercy is unlimited, the mercy of Allah is unlimited. With that, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, لَأَمْسَكْتُمْ خَشْيَةَ الْإِنْفَاقِ. You would withhold out of fear of spending. You would love to keep this mercy to yourself only, and not to give anyone else. Why? Because وَكَانَ الْإِنسَانُ قَطُورًا. And man has been stingy. We all have met some people in our life who don't like to see us happy, who wish for us to fail, although we don't ask anything from them, but with that, out of this enmity that they have, or the jealousy that they have, they work on destroying you, or they work on causing problems to you. We all face such people. Such people, if they get the authority of spreading the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, they would keep it to themselves and prevent others from getting them. And also, we all met people who keep giving us advices and telling us how we should work in the community and what we should do in the community, and they're teaching us what we should do, but the moment you tell them, put your hand in your pocket and give some money so we can do some work, they run away. Why? Because وَكَانَ الْإِنسَانُ قَطُورًا, because man is stingy. Inshallah, no, everyone. Now it's getting, this lecture is, it has a lot of negative energy in it. But inshallah, we can release this negative energy in the next lecture when we speak about the third verse. And also we can release this negative energy with the loud salawat ala Muhammad wa Ali Muhammad. That's a loud salawat. I don't know what a quiet salat is. Sallu ala Muhammad wa Ali Muhammad. Sallu ala Muhammad wa Ali Muhammad. We'll go to the third and last point. Should we continue or are you tired? You're tired, Ahsan. You're tired? So it's only Hajj Muhammad, doesn't matter. The third point, the importance of choosing our terms when preaching Islam. This is a very important point. It's short, but it's very important. It's short, in 2 minutes, then we'll be done. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, إِنَّ الْإِنسَانَ لَفِي خُسْرٍ. Surely man is in loss. Loss is a trade term. It's a term that is used in business, correct, Hajj? And you run a few businesses in the community, you should know. Or should we advertise your business? Pay me after the lecture. So loss is a trade term. The Quran used the trade terms in many verses. For example, to mention two verses, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim, أُولَٰئِكَ الَّذِينَ اشْتَرُوا الضَّلَالَةَ بِالْهُدَىٰ فَمَا رَبِحَتْ تِجَارَتُهُمْ وَمَا كَانُوا مُهْتَدِينَ, which means those are the ones who have purchased their business, has brought no profit to them. So he used the terms business, purchasing, trading, and so on. In another verse, Allah says, يَا أَيُّهَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا هَلْ أَدُلُّكُمْ عَلَىٰ تِجَارَةٍ, تجارة again, a trade or a business, تُنْجِيكُمْ مِنْ عَذَابٍ أَلِيمٍ, should I guide you to a business, to a trade that can save you from a painful punishment. The Quran used trade terms to make it easy on people to comprehend and understand the verses that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala revealed on His Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Why is that? Because most of the people of Mecca and Medina used to be trademen. They used to work in business. So out of the mercy and the wisdom of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He used terms that people are familiar with. Terms that people are close to. If they read the verses, they would understand what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is trying to say. Not complicated terms. Now go open the Quran, you read Madana, قُلْ هُوَ اللَّهُ أَحَدٌ. You understand what it means, it's easy to understand. Go and open a book of philosophy, and good luck to understand one sentence from what they say. Right? Because they have no wisdom in the philosophy that they write. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, out of His wisdom, He used the terms that people are familiar with. So it becomes easier for people to understand, for the verses to reach the minds of people and to enter into their hearts. Now, This should be a lesson for us. When we want to preach Islam or to teach this divine religion, we have to choose our terms based on the time and the place that we live in. Based on the time and the place that we live in. Also, you have to study the level of those who you are preaching to understand how you should approach them. In no way I can accept to follow Islam or to preach Islam through a Salafi mentality, which means to follow the same way that those who came before us practiced Islam, or the same way they preached Islam. This is not correct. It's not enough to just read some verses and some narrations and to go outside and preach Islam by memorizing them. You should study the time and the place that you live in. And you should choose the terms based on the time and the place that you live in. And this is a problem that we face today. Most of you, inshallah, they have a Risala Amaliya at home. True or not? Open the Risala Amaliya and try to understand what it says. Good luck. In most of the rulings, it says it's pak. What's pak? Pak is an Urdu term that means tahir. So an Urdu guy was translating the Risala, he said it's pak. And now for 50 years, we still use the word pak. It became an English word. So even with our Islamic books, we should also choose the terms that are suitable for the time and the place that we live in. And when we want to speak about Islam or preach Islam, we should also look at the time and the place that we live in. This is what we understand from the saying of Allah, إِنَّ الْإِنسَانَ لَفِي خُسْرٍ. Surely man is in loss, and Allah knows best. وَصَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَى مُحَمَّدٍ وَآلِي مُحَمَّدٍ.